From the Catholic Underground.
Today on the show, good innovations. When is a crucifix not a crucifix? The Benedict option, our picks of the week, and so much more. The Catholic Underground starts right now. We are reluctantly crouched at the starting line, but it is time for the CU Weekly. We're cutting through the noise of the digital continent. It's episode number 289. I am Father Chris Decker. If you are listening live, you can join us in the chat room at CatholicUnderground.tv. Joining me this week, as they always do, we've got Olivia Galino. She is a student of life, and she is the resident Italian food critic here at the Catholic Underground. Hello, Olivia.
Hello, everyone.
Should we change your title, or are you cool with Italian food critic?
I am very comfortable being the resident Italian food critic.
She gets
I hope I get to exercise my authority soon.
We totally need a food show. Yeah.
I think so, too.
Also, Jeff Blackwell, he's the technical director of the CU. He's the commandant of the Jeff Star 1 near-Earth orbit satellite. He joins us in a flash. Hey, Jeff.
Live and in color this week, by the way.
That's exactly right. Normally, Jeff's in black and white. And also, running the video feed is Katie, the cat lady, for all the right reasons. Richard, hello, Katie.
Hello. I don't get a choice in my name.
No, she sure doesn't. It was drawn by lot, and that's the lot you got. And also, Kathleen is on assignment, which may secretly mean she's on vacation. That's okay. It's all right. So innovation makes our brains think and societies grow, from radio broadcasting to screwing in the first light bulb to sending men to the moon and Google search. They may seem outlandish, but the biggest life changes are the ones that tend to sneak up on us. And, you know, really as a society, certainly in the United States, it really was innovation that made us who we are.
Exactly.
Not just discovering fire. Well, we didn't discover fire, but improving upon, you know, things that are fired, right? Just thinking about, like, the engine.
Exactly.
And especially, like, the bicycle engine that powered the Wright brothers' flyer.
That's right. Yeah, and what's funny is that people kind of tilted their nose or looked down their noses at the Wright brothers and called their activities ridiculous or kind of a waste of time. And, I mean, where would we be now if we didn't have...
And so many innovations, they do tend to kind of sneak up on folks. And in fact, in a Time.com article speaking about innovation, there's a list of how innovation comes about and how people usually react to it. And so here's the gist, right? So whenever there's an innovation, like say, let's say the laser, right? I've never heard of it, is the first stage. I've heard of it, but I don't understand it.
Yep, I hear that one a lot.
Think about the first time you experienced a laser pointer. Mm-hmm. You know? Oh, it's neat. It's just projecting a little dot onto the screen. And my professor has spent $900 for one of these things. And it's the size of a cannon, and not a printer. Let's see. I understand it, but I don't see how it's useful. Mm-hmm. Why can't they just go point at the board?
Yeah, exactly. You know?
I see how it could be fun for rich people, but not for me. I think the Apple Watch is at that stage. Because, Jeff, would you say that the Apple Watch is an innovation?
It is indeed, yeah.
I don't have one.
I don't either.
I see how it could be fun for rich people, but not for me.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. That's where I am in the stage of innovating. I use it, but it's just a toy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's becoming more useful for me is the next step.
We're taking a turn.
Followed by, I use it all the time. I could not imagine life without it. And seriously, people lived without it?
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. I mean, I think about my iPhone that way, actually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
or really any smartphone is, you know, you go from not hearing from it to saying, I don't really see how it's useful. I mean, it's a telephone. And then you have it and you realize that basically, at least from the priest standpoint, Father, why XYZ? Mm-hmm. Well, they don't know that I can surreptitiously Google search something. and then to actually have kind of a little catechetical thing right in my pocket.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wow. But it does, you do follow a kind of a progression.
Yeah, I think resistance is definitely the first stage when it comes to new and exciting innovations, because we look at them and we think, it's kind of a novelty. I guess it would be cool, but I don't need it, or I can't see how it could ever be universal.
Right.
And so you just kind of write it off as something, well, that's cool, but, you know, let's get back to real life. And then, lo and behold, like with the airplane, you know, 5 years later, people were like, I never realized that this was so important. And the Wright brothers were just nodding their heads. We tried to tell you.
Yeah.
You
know? Right, exactly. So, yeah, it wasn't until 1908 that people actually recognized what they had done. And then within less than 20 years, you had the first commercial, or I don't know if you call it commercial, but civil aviation. Mm-hmm. You had the carrying of people from one place to another. And then, of course, once World War II comes around, and really the beginnings of, or I should say maybe the end of World War I, I don't remember how large aircraft were in World War I. I know that they
were
they did
play a part.
They played a part, mm-hmm. Yeah.
They'd select a bomb and then drop them by hand just over the side there. Yeah.
just like when Jeff goes to the drive-thru. He takes change and he just tosses it in there. Sorry, no, Jeff doesn't go to drive-through restaurants.
No, I don't.
So it's just amazing that innovation does this, and it comes from the most unlikely places too. So HP and Apple, they didn't come from a think tank; they came from a garage.
Mm-hmm.
Airplanes, of course, came from a bicycle shop in Dayton, and then it's really interesting that neat innovations, big ones, don't really happen with PR departments. And again, you think about somebody like Steve Jobs,
mm-hmm.
who was his own PR department for the longest time. And the things that seem to be the biggest innovations that become kind of the household name are things that don't require flashy publications.
Right.
You just see it as something that's useful, and mm-hmm. you eventually start using it.
Right.
So innovation is a good thing. Now, we could twist it a little bit and say, what about innovation in things like, I don't know, the liturgy? Because mm-hmm. doesn't it become more relevant if there are innovations?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the Second Vatican Council is pretty clear in Sacra Sanctum Concilium. I believe it's number 22 or 23. Maybe it's number 14. I don't remember. But it says that really nobody can innovate on the liturgy.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody, even if he may be a priest, may add, subtract, or change anything in the liturgy of his own volition without prior approval from the bishop or the apostolic see. And so we see that in technology and in society, innovations are important for the development of peoples, the progress of peoples. But then when it comes to something that is intended to be a measuring rod of how we come to God,
mm-hmm.
Innovation really isn't necessary in that
exactly.
sense. Because God in his liturgy remains relevant
mm-hmm.
if we go to him. So anyway, not that we needed to turn the religious corner, but it's worth saying that not all innovation is bad,
mm-hmm.
but not all attempts at innovation are good.
Right. I mean, you have to know when you can improve on something and when you can't. And the Mass is one place where you can't improve on what Christ has already established in the Mass. So, you know, things like technology and smartphones and starting, we can see the first little bits of that all the way back to the Industrial Revolution, and that's just, we can see a progression now, and that's because we're human and we're working with human materials and we're trying to make things better. We're always in a state of becoming, you know.
Yeah.
But when it comes to the Mass, like, that's something that's really not in time. That's looking towards heaven, and heaven doesn't change. So
I'm glad that heaven doesn't change.
Me too.
Because I'd probably lose my way. And I don't think that's possible in heaven, you know, to lose where you are. So that's a good thing. God is the unmoved mover. So it's beautiful to think about heaven as a place where there is no need for innovation, because it simply is.
Mm-hmm.
Mm,
but nice. Would you say that that experiencing the innovations of technology and in society can give us a hunger for that thing that which does not change?
Yeah, I think you have a point there, because we look at things that are transient. You know, I've had this computer for 5 years, and suddenly it's not working so great anymore. So I guess I got to get another one. And then I think about, you know, how many computers am I going to have to own in my life? And I just feel like that you can really see, and especially when in our technological age, when things are kind of in and out of style within a year or 2 years,
yeah,
you really see the transience of things. Like when I think back to my first cell phone, I'm just, what was that brick? You know, how did I use that? You know? And so I think that definitely puts me in touch with well, all of these things do change, but what doesn't? And so, yeah, I think you're right.
That's right. So not all innovation is bad, but some of it is unnecessary when it comes to the things that are eternal. Ah, well, we hope that was heavy enough for you. We're the Catholic Underground. Well, we are the Catholic Underground.
There we go.
It's one of those shows, folks. We're online at catholicunderground.tv. I am Father Chris Decker. Joining me, Jeff Blackwell, also Olivia Galino. We're going to have a look at our picks of the week. They're coming up a little bit later. But first, we want to talk about something that's just downright trippy. Okay, we talked about innovation. If you've ever really wondered what computers see, the answer may be nothing, but it also may be something weird. So Google sets up a feedback loop in its image recognition neural network. So this is the thing that you actually can use on Google image search. Whenever you put in it, like you drag an image in, you say search for things like this. Well, Google's neural network goes together and starts its engines up and starts looking for patterns in the pictures. But whenever Google attempts to kind of see how this works, it creates some really terrifying hallucinatory images.
Yes.
So this is the thing, right? They feed a picture into the network, and they ask the computer program, we'll just call it Hal, to recognize a feature of it, and then to modify the picture to emphasize the feature that it recognizes. And then that's fed back into the network, and then it says, okay, now recognize features and emphasize them based upon this thing that you recognize. So it's kind of like an infinite regress. And so at a low level, the neural network of Google might just detect like the edges on an image. So it looks kind of like an impressionist painting.
Mm-hmm.
But say you ask Google to find animals, right? So find a dog in this painting, this painting from Victorian England. Well, it's really a disturbing hallucination that shows up. So you see like a dog at the end of somebody's hand, and you see a dog in somebody's face, and then you see a dog making up horses, and it's really kind of strange. And so not that we need to spend a whole lot of time on this, but I wonder if this is really what a computer does see as it's learning, because Google is really putting a lot of resources into this to help us as human beings to help make our lives easier. And so, I mean, I wonder, Jeff, if this is going to be what becomes Skynet and overtakes us.
Oh.
And how does a computer see me, you know?
True, yeah. That's the thing that hit me as you were talking about that, because you can find, I guess, really objects and everything. Clouds come to mind immediately,
right.
You know.
Yeah, and so if you tell Google to look for animals in clouds, we'll put a link in the show notes. You will see some of the strangest, most hallucinatory images. I don't know.
It goes way beyond surrealist paintings and things.
That's right. And speaking of surrealist paintings, Bolivian President Evo Morales may have wanted to ask a priest first when he presented Pope Francis with a very unusual gift. You may have seen it on the social media, but Olivia, it looked like a hammer and sickle with a corpus of Christ hanging on the hammer bit.
Well, it looked like that because that's what it was.
Oh.
And if you have seen the picture of it, then you've probably seen Pope Francis's face right next to it. And I think the look on his face really says it all. The mix of shock and just,
what's going on
just
there right now?
Is this real? Is this real life? And I think that the shock and awe value of it comes from the fact that it is a hammer and sickle, and when we have to think about what that is. I mean, we come from a democratic society, but we're not immune to images of the hammer and sickle. And so we know that it's an offshoot or a product of the socialist revolution.
Right. So the symbol actually is a symbol of work.
Right.
Right.
It's the hammer is the workers and the sickle is the peasants, right?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right.
Something like that. And so it's something that is it's looking at work as the kind of fundamental unit of the society, and it's disturbing to see Christ put on an image like that. Not to say that Christ didn't work, because obviously we know that he did for at least 30 years, and then his ministry definitely counts as work.
He certainly used a hammer. his life.
And possibly even a sickle. You never know.
Yeah.
But what's disturbing about it is because we still understand symbols on a certain level.
Yeah.
And so what's disturbing about it is that we're taking something beautiful, like the cross. Mm-hmm. The cross is Christ's throne. And what are we doing to it? We're taking away his throne and we're putting work behind it. We're saying that Christ died not for our salvation, but that he died for good labor conditions. Yeah. And it completely devalues the gospel. It devalues his death. And it's confusing to a society to see Christ hanging on a cross like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And those are the things that are important when we talk about symbols, because the world in which we live today is trending very much towards this new nominalism, mm-hmm. where if I don't like the way something is defined, I simply make up a new definition for it. You know, so for example, Jeff, if I don't like the definition of eyeglasses, because I think it's lensist,
mm-hmm.
then I might choose another word to describe your eyeglasses. You know, I might call them oculholes or something like that.
Wow.
You know, and that's the word that I begin to use, and that's the one that I begin to propagate, and maybe it catches on because it leaves out the lens because for whatever reason I don't like tempered glass of any kind. You know, and so I just kind of redefine a word, even though what you're wearing are, in fact, eyeglasses.
Mm. Yeah.
And so symbols and the words that go behind them, their definitions, are incredibly important. And as you're saying, Olivia, properly ordered symbols mm-hmm. have actually one design. Properly ordered symbols draw us in a direction.
That's right.
Especially if it's religious.
Exactly. That's why we have statues and paintings of religious art and themes in churches, because they help draw us into what we're doing in the church, in the Mass. But even you see this, I actually saw this as an objection to the gift of the hammer and sickle crucifix.
Yeah.
Someone was saying, well, you know, and you go to Rome and you see these obelisks or these towers. There's the most famous one in St. Peter's Square. And these are plunder from the Egyptian Empire.
Yeah.
And they were taken by the Roman Empire and put there as a symbol of power. And so we see those things, and if you look on top of it, you see, I forget what's on the top of the one in St. Peter's. But
there is a starburst and I think a cross on top of it.
Yeah, and then on others you'll see like the Blessed Virgin Mary or something like that. So you see these symbols of Christ and of Mary, who is also a symbol of the church.
Yep.
And you get kind of confused. Well, like, isn't that the same thing? They took something pagan or something secular, and then they put a religious symbol on it, and it's the same thing. But the reality is that it's not, because when the church, in her wisdom, took those symbols, she said that what you were doing in establishing your power with these kind of symbols, you're telling people that you're in charge, and you're looking for power, and you're looking to establish an earthly kingdom. And they, by putting Mary or a cross on top, they're telling you, that's not what you're looking for. You're looking for the eternal kingdom.
Right.
And so they're redirecting, they're basically connecting heaven and earth by uniting those symbols together. And you see that all throughout Rome and the ancient and cities that have pieces of the ancient world. You see columns in Catholic churches. The Pantheon, it is now a basilica.
Yeah, Mary and all the saints instead of all of the unknown gods.
Exactly.
Yeah, the Pantheon was a really interesting play because the Romans said, well, you know, there are plenty of other gods that we probably don't know about, and we don't want to anger any mm-hmm. of them. So this is going to be the temple of temples so that we can just include them all.
Mm-hmm.
So that the gods will be satiated and they won't strike us all down by lightning.
Right.
And so whenever the church for want of a better term, inherits all of these things, they naturally say, well, now what is the eternal truth that was in shadow?
Mm-hmm.
You see, they're looking not just for the symbol, but for properly ordering it.
Right.
And so, yes, the Pantheon today is the Church of Mary and all the saints.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, at the head of the Pantheon is not a pagan altar, but a high altar on which the Mass is offered.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So what you're saying, Olivia, is that's not the same case with the corpus on the hammer and sickle.
I would say no. I'd say that it's almost the exact opposite. You know, in the cases like we were talking about, you're raising the secular to be something that looks towards heaven.
Yeah.
But in the case of the hammer and sickle crucifix, you're taking something divine and you're reducing it to the secular. And you need look no further than the socialist ideals about the gospel. I think Pope Leo XIII, had something to say about that.
He sure did. Pope Leo XIII was one of the Holy Fathers who had to deal with socialism, and very much so. He said in the fifth paragraph of his encyclical, Quod Apostolici Muneris, I believe.
Very nice.
He says, "For indeed, although the socialists stealing the very gospel itself with a view to deceive more easily the unwary, have been accustomed to distort it so as to suit their own purposes, nevertheless, so great is the difference between their depraved teachings and the most pure doctrine of Christ that none greater could exist. For what participation hath justice with injustice, or what fellowship hath light with darkness?" Mm-hmm. He's quoting the scriptures there. And so that Pope Leo XIII makes it very clear that there are certainly some political systems that no matter what they say cannot square with the gospel. And we see this arising again as socialism is, it's certainly part of a lot of the Western world. I mean, if you look at a lot of the countries, even the ones that the Holy Father is visiting right now, socialism is the order of the day. And it attempts, actually, as we saw with that crucifix with the hammer and sickle, it attempts to say that Christ can exist alongside this government regime. Mm-hmm. But the very foundation of socialism pits the state acting in the place of God.
Exactly.
And so you can put a corpus on a hammer and sickle, but that just shows all the more how antithetical those things are. And that's what Pope Leo XIII, way back when, was attempting to say, and his words really ring true now. And so I think perhaps just in the look on his face, Pope Francis was saying, no.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there has been some thought as to what he actually said, because the audio was very low.
Right.
It was originally thought that whenever he received this as a gift from the president of Bolivia, he said that that's not right.
Right.
Mm.
He may have said, "I didn't know that," because there was a discussion going on about the Jesuit priest who was the original sculptor of this crucifix, or so-called crucifix.
Right.
And so there, we don't know exactly what the Holy Father's words were, but it was obvious that he was very uncomfortable with it. Yeah. You know,
I had heard an interview with a reporter from our Sunday Visitor.
Yep.
A news reporter and a priest all said the same thing, that they were offended.
Yeah. It's a deeply offensive image because, again, for those who know socialism and its aims, socialism aims to allow the people to rise and to allow work to bring them salvation, earthly salvation. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's why communism is so dangerous.
Yes.
And in a sense, the state takes the place of God. And so if you work, the state will grant you salvation.
Right.
That is completely irreconcilable with what we believe about Christ. You know, we don't do anything to merit salvation. We've actually done very little. Jesus Christ saves us from our sins, though we do not deserve it, and he lifts us from that by his own grace. And so because he has done this for us, we work for bringing the kingdom about. We work for the gospel, which is a completely different understanding of being forced into labor so that I may be saved, but rather I am saved, and so therefore I labor for God.
There you go.
You know? And so symbols are so important that way.
They are. And I think that's why, even if you don't know anything about socialism, you can look at what this gift was, and you can inherently sense that something's wrong.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, if you look at just the pure facts about it, you took Christ off the cross.
Yeah.
And if you know anything about the cross, then you know that by doing that, you've shut the door to salvation.
Right. That's right.
There's no pathway anymore.
Because Christ without the cross is robbing him of his throne, as you say, right?
Yeah.
It's emptying a symbol of its meaning. And that's why I'm always very clear whenever I'm in a religious goods shop that the crucifix is it stands on its own, mm-hmm. you know. And in fact, that's why we as Catholics certainly venerate the crucifix, specifically the crucifix and not just the cross.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because the cross, certainly without Christ on it, can be a symbol of resurrection. Mm-hmm. But we recognize in the crucified Christ on the cross also the resurrection, because mm-hmm. it is a complete and full symbol.
Right.
And so hopefully this helps you in the discussions that you'll no doubt be having with your friends. As you probably see this on social media, and you might even, you probably won't see it on the news, but you might, because the Holy Father responded to a dignitary of a foreign nation in a way that was other than cordial. He was very nice. He was very kind. Mm. But at the same time, he recognized that I'm a public figure. I represent the Catholic Church, and this does not represent what we believe.
Right.
So, symbols are important. Make sure that whatever you wear around your neck, you mean to wear it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, make sure that whatever you have on your wall in your home and your office and your car, mm-hmm. you mean to have it, mm-hmm. because symbols speak a language. Just as architecture speaks a language, just as our words speak a language, symbols do as well. We are the Catholic Underground. Alrighty, gang, it is the Catholic Underground, and you're listening, and we're happy that you are. I am Father Chris Decker. Joining us, we have Jeff Blackwell in the audio cave there, representing DC Comics. You know, Jeff actually does move that quickly. And then, of course, Olivia Galino, she's over there. And Katie in the video cave, you can hear her.
Cheese!
That's right. Do you know in Spanish what you say instead of cheese? Whenever somebody's going to take your picture.
Queso. I don't know.
No. I have no idea.
Well, what happens to the ends of your mouth when you say cheese in English?
They
go back.
They
cheese,
go back.
Cheese. It's to get you to smile.
Mm-hmm.
That's why you say cheese.
Right.
You know, unless you're, you know, really mopey and you go, cheese.
Yeah.
You know, cheese. But in at least when I was in Mexico, whenever they would take our picture for the language school or whatever,
yeah.
they would say, you got whiskey. So you say whiskey.
Whiskey.
Yeah, whiskey.
Whiskey.
Because whiskey, you're right, exactly. Whiskey makes you smile in mm-hmm. Spanish.
Yeah.
And now Jeff can smile in Spanish.
Yeah. Tequila.
Well, I guess that'll work.
Cerveza.
That'll work, too, I guess, if you're actually drinking it. Yeah. It's a lot easier to smile if you've
Margarita.
So as Western civilization yes. continues to appear at least be in decline, some folks are presenting an idea that's not altogether new to save it, and it's what is being called the Benedict option. Not Pope Benedict the 16th, but the original, whose feast day we celebrated not too long ago, mm-hmm. Saint Benedict himself. You know, these are strange times for Christians in the United States and in the Western world. Christian values and principles that form this nation really are not guiding it at present in many ways in the top levels. And you know, I was reading Archbishop Sheen, who is kind of a spiritual mentor for me, even though he is presently dead and awaiting the resurrection mm. of the body, his words continue to live and to ring true. I mean, you want to talk about somebody who spoke about socialism?
Yeah,
he's one of them. Communism, doubly so. And he speaks in his book Freedom, Freedom and God, I believe is the name of it. He said that, you know, a society that attempts to remove Christ doesn't just become Christless, it becomes anti-Christ.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Because there's no way in which a state, which is exactly what socialist governments do, there's no yeah. way in which a state can say, well, God is not just irrelevant. Because if God is irrelevant, then it's acknowledging that that he has no power. Well, the state knows that God has power.
Mm-hmm.
And so a state that says God is irrelevant will eventually say God is antithetical mm-hmm. to who we are. And so a society that removes God and the moral order and attempts to establish itself as the moral order in civil order has to become anti-God, mm-hmm. you see. And so we see this happening. In fact, you even hear our culture being called post-Christian, even anti-Christian, you know, we certainly hear that. And so Rod Dreher, who is an Orthodox Christian writer from Louisiana, incidentally,
yeah.
has been writing about what he calls the Benedict option for several years. And so he says that it is, quote, a limited strategic withdrawal of Christians from the mainstream of American popular culture for the sake of shoring up our understanding of what the church is and what we must do to be the church. And so one of the things that that Saint Benedict himself did was to withdraw.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, that's what the very first hermits, the very first monks did. And they did this not to completely say that the world has nothing for me,
mm-hmm.
but to say, well, I need to go to God first, and then God tells me how to live in the world,
mm-hmm.
right? And in fact, Jeff, you know the cliche, huh, that we live in the world, not of it.
Right.
Well, Roger is suggesting that's what Saint Benedict was doing, and he wonders if maybe it's not time to do that. He says the church must do this not to hide away as a pure remnant, but to strengthen itself to be the church for the world, the same way that Benedict did in the 5th century to preserve Christianity as the Roman Empire crumbled around him. Mm-hmm. See, because that's what was happening in St. Benedict's own time, is the Roman Empire was becoming increasingly more and more depraved.
Mm-hmm.
They were actually getting away from the worship of their own gods, and they were beginning to worship themselves,
mm-hmm.
you know? And Pope Benedict XVI says it well, and you've heard me say it on the show before. A society that does not worship Christ will always worship itself.
Mm-hmm.
That was happening in the pagan world with Saint Benedict. And so Benedict kind of goes off to himself, is like so many of the hermits and monks, and he developed what kind of a fivefold system that mm-hmm. Rod Dreher suggests. And of course, we like lists. So number one was... liturgical. So he lists five traits of a community that might be exercising this Benedict option. Liturgical
is the first.
Well-ordered liturgy.
Mm-hmm.
We talked a little bit about that, about symbols and their importance. We talked about how it's important to make sure that innovation in the Mass is unnecessary.
Mm-hmm.
And so well-celebrated liturgy, because it is a celebration of the eternal. So liturgy would be the first thing. Number two, disciplined and ascetically oriented. Of course, Benedict lived in a hole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and he was actually content to live in this hole until there were some others that were around him that said, we want to live in community. We want to not escape the world, but we need to be strengthened by Christ. Would you come and be the abbot?
Mm-hmm.
And that's what Saint Benedict did. A Benedict option community might also have a strong pastor, a strong creed, and enforce it.
Mm-hmm.
See, one of the things that Rod Dreher is suggesting here is that this is not just a Catholic thing,
mm-hmm.
but that if someone were oriented towards liturgy, as we know many of our Christian brothers and sisters are, there are a lot of churches that still retain a liturgical style of worship, to be disciplined, to be oriented towards simplification of life. To have a strong pastor, to have a creed that aligns in as much as possible with the Apostles' Creed at the very least, and to enforce it, to hold each other accountable. There's an accountability to this. To also demand serious and steady involvement, to show up.
Yeah.
I tell you, that's one of the things in any parish is people showing up.
Yeah. First step.
Exactly. And then open to outsiders who are interested, but must not change its practices to be seeker-friendly.
Mm.
That is one of the things that we see happening in our own Western culture, right. And what many, it seems to me, Olivia, expect the Catholic Church to do.
Oh, yeah. We expect the Church to, in order to speak the language of the people, she has to change herself to be like the people.
Mm-hmm.
When, in fact, she can speak the language, or a language that people will understand, but while remaining completely herself.
Yeah.
And it's hard for us to imagine that because we think of, being part of something as being completely part of it. But it's like you said, like, you have to be in the world, not of the world. And so we don't have to be completely transformed by the world itself in order to be in it and to be meaningful in it.
Right.
And that's something that, you know, John Paul II wanted to do with the Vatican Council. That's why a lot of his fingerprints are on those documents. And what he's saying is... the world does need to understand the church better, and she does need to be speaking the language of the people. And so he gave them philosophical tools in order to be able to do that, theological and new insights. And so he's basically, he set up for us in a big way, a way to speak to the world in a really meaningful way. We just have to tap into that and realize that, you know, changing our liturgy or changing our social programs is
or
not,
our doctrine.
Yeah, or doctrine itself is it's not going to be the way to draw people in, because then we become a flux. We don't even know what we are,
right?
And we're trying to attract people to it. It doesn't work.
And it's interesting you say that about how the church is called to be kind of the unmoved,
yeah,
the unmoved stone, mm-hmm, the rock in the midst of a culture in flux. Oftentimes, folks will say, "Well, you know, Jesus ate with sinners. Jesus, mm-hmm, ate with tax collectors. Jesus talked to prostitutes." Yes, but he never at any point was not himself.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, that's what called them out of their sin. That's what called them out of their lifestyle that was not godly, was the fact that Jesus never changed his tune.
Mm-hmm.
He is the Word made flesh. Yeah. And so he simply, in and of himself, orients everything that is not godly back to himself,
mm-hmm,
to say, turn, which is, of course, what the prophets were talking about. Amos, who was in the scriptures for this weekend's liturgy, had just finished telling Israel, no, turn not away from the Lord, but turn back to him. That's what, mm-hmm, all the prophets did. Turn your hearts toward him, and he will turn back to you.
Because, mm-hmm,
he never turned the opposite direction. He's, yeah, waiting for you to turn back. That's what Jesus did. He was the physical manifestation, the embodiment of God wanting to stay turned towards his people and to have them turn themselves toward him.
Right.
And so that very much is part of the notion of this Benedict option. So it could be a parish or a school, and it would counter the culture rather than accommodate,
mm-hmm,
the surrounding culture. According to Dreher, he said that the Benedict option parish or school would grow organically from the parish up, and it would develop Christians strong in their faith, and so that they could counter the culture and would build well-catechized family. This sounds like a movement that's already happening in a lot of places called the intentional discipleship model,
mm-hmm,
where priests will form just a small group of disciples who then go out in their own parish and, mm-hmm, and attempt to spread the gospel by mode of life, by the scriptures, by encouraging sacraments and things like that. And then, of course, there's something that has built on this called the Buckley option. Andrew Walker offers the Buckley option as an alternative to the Benedict option. And, of course, William Buckley united, organized, and inspired and cajoled the fledgling conservative movement when American progressivism was triumphant in the 1950s. This was after World War II and the New Deal, and those things had kind of laid waste to opposing political views. So Buckley was just kind of this guy who enjoyed life, right? Mm-hmm. He had the joie de vivre, and so he was kind of exercising the Benedict option, but in an active way, mm-hmm, actually running out into the culture, right?
Mm-hmm.
Never shirking from the responsibility of saying, this is who I am, this is what I do, this is what I believe, and I guess to coin a meme, come at me, bro, you know? And so I wonder if there's not something to be said about this as well.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff, given the choice between a Benedict option, which is kind of a withdrawing to your parish,
mm-hmm,
gathering yourself, and then going out, the Buckley option says to kind of do it while you're in place, right? You're in the midst of the culture.
Yeah.
And you know, I don't know, does...
I kind of like the Benedict option because you have that support structure,
right?
And so
and
you
many
know,
Catholics today don't know what they believe.
Yeah, and
they don't. They're not catechized.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Anyway, but I mean,
I'm lacking. Yeah. I'll admit it too. But I like being able to to hear other people's stories.
Sure.
As they're out there on the street or in their neighborhoods, communities, and bring it back to the fold, and then share, yeah, it with others, and then, you know, go out stronger even.
So, I mean, just by way of question, Olivia, how do you think the church should engage the world today? Is the answer, do you think, running back to your parish?
Hmm.
Or do you say, well, I will attempt to catechize, you know, I'll go to Mass on Sunday, but I'm going to be out in the middle of it all.
Right. I mean, not to sound too Catholic, but maybe it's both and.
I think you could be correct.
I think it's a little bit of both, yeah, because it has to start in the parish in some sense, like what you're saying with catechesis. You know,
right,
people have to understand what they believe and what they profess. And so it has to start there because we need well-formed Catholics and Christians who will then go out into the world and have something to say. They, you know, they have the conviction to say it, but let's give them the tools to be able to explain it. And I think so. I think it has to be a little bit of both.
That's actually kind of what the gospel was talking about today. Mm-hmm. This is, of course, the sending of the apostles. Jesus commissions them to go and drive out the unclean spirits. And while they do, the scriptures tell us that the apostles, first of all, preached repentance. Mm-hmm. Remember that calling back thing, that turning your heart back to God? That was the first thing the apostles did. After they had spent time in that, well, the seminary with Jesus, he sends them out, like on their first internship, right? And he sends them with spiritual authority, but the first thing they do is preach repentance. Mm-hmm. And then the scriptures tell us they drive out demons, and they anoint with oil those who are sick and cure them. And so one of the things I told my parishioners this weekend, that the church, her role is the salvation of souls. That is the first thing. And she does this primarily through the activity of the apostles. And so the church is kind of like a quartermaster. So if you were, if you're ever in the military, a quartermaster is kind of the inventory guy, right? Mm-hmm. I need this and this and this. And you go to the quartermaster says, yep, everything checks out, here you go. And then you go back out into battle or wherever you're going with it. The church is the place for us to find quarter, to hunker, to come and allow our needs to be met in a very real sense, our need for spiritual authority given to be shared with us. To be met. And it is there, and only then, once the demons are cleansed, once our hearts are turned back to the Lord, once we are sacramentally fed, to go out into the world. Mm-hmm. And Tom Hoops over at the NC Register, National Catholic Register, said that there's another option. He calls it the St. Francis option. He didn't see creation as a problem to be solved. He didn't see culture as a problem to be solved either. He wasn't a whiner. He didn't complain about priests, even whenever his rights were being trampled on. He didn't complain that the church was too Catholic or not Catholic enough. He didn't complain that the Pope's priorities were wrong or that bishops and priests had become corrupt and lazy. Mm-hmm. No, Francis simply lived his faith. Mm-hmm. He spoke about, in fact, some of the phrases you won't see Francis saying, which he did, were about how important being Catholic were, about living your Catholic faith, about receiving the sacraments, how important those things were. And then, of course, the Francis option makes sense because the world has a hunger for authentic Christian witness. We can't stay shut up in our parishes and just kind of snuggle in the pew, you know, because it's tempting. It's really, even as a priest, it's very tempting to just stay in the rectory or to stay in the sanctuary and to not go out into the world, to not turn on the YouTube camera, you know, every week. But that's impossible because the world is not averted to Christian witness. In fact, whenever you have a society that is becoming more and more anti-God or anti-Christ, the world, the people in the world tend to be more drawn to like a Blessed Mother Teresa or a Saint John Paul II or even a Pope Francis. And so imagine what would happen, Tom Hoop says, if you and I were more like them. You know, if we really had this evangelical nature to us, even as we were living our faith.
Right. And I think you're right. It's something that people are starving for. And I just kind of got an image of, you know, what does an animal do when it's starving? It gets very violent and very angry, and it starts lashing out at anything and everything.
True.
And is that not a metaphor for what we see in our society today? We see very aggressive natures. We see people who are lashing out because they're starving themselves
and they don't know where to turn.
Exactly. Right. Yeah. It's just this blind anger because I don't know what to do and I don't have what I need. So I'm just going to I have to do something. And so, I mean, I think that's a symbol, not that people don't want Christian witness, that they need it. They desperately, desperately need it so much that they're starving for it.
So where do we start though? You know, it's like
CatholicUnderground.tv.
Yeah.
No, I think you start. I mean, maybe you're listening to the podcast for the first time, and you're saying, "Where do I start? This is striking to the core of my heart." Well, the first place that you should start, if you certainly are a Catholic, is to make sure that you are all readied with grace. I would say that if you are a Catholic, this is the first time you're hearing this. When was the last time that you thought about your sin? When was the last time that you considered the horrific nature of sin? When was the last time that you found sorrow for your sin and you allowed the Spirit to convict you about your sin? Because if we don't start with recognizing our own inclinations towards sinfulness, our own concupiscence, our inclination towards sin, then we're easily going to point it out in everybody else. That's what Jesus talks about when he says, you're worried about the plank in you're worried about the speck in your brother's eye and you're not seeing the plank in your own.
Yeah, right.
That's the first place to start. Right. You're Catholic, go to confession. Make a good confession. That fills you with innumerable sacramental and sanctifying graces, and that allows you to begin a walk. And that walk that happens after we have been filled with the grace of the sacrament of reconciliation is a walk in trying to understand the how of my faith. How do I genuflect? How do I receive communion? How do I listen to the word at Mass? How do I read the scriptures? How do I pray? That leads to the what of faith. The stuff of catechesis, and then also the why of faith. Why do I believe this? Mm-hmm. And all of those things can't come together unless I first recognize, as many of our Protestant brothers and sisters say, that I am a sinner in need of a Savior.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very important that way. And so after we start the journey of the how and the why and the what, that leads us necessarily into our parish community, into mm-hmm. church, into a living relationship with a living God lived out in the mystical body of Christ in a community.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's when you see all these options beginning to come together. And also, I would say, Jeff, too, and Olivia, you might agree, is to draw people around you that want to be holy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because we are damned or saved together. It's true.
Yeah.
We are damned or saved together. And so if you bring people around you that are also seeking after holiness, and we see a lot of this happening with the Christian movements of young people, they want holiness. They mm-hmm. want to get to heaven. And so seek community that will bring you closer to heaven. And then, and maybe then, whenever you have some of the friends who are not seeking holiness, not seeking heaven, you can be like Jesus was whenever he would walk into the bar and sit with sinners.
Mm-hmm.
He was completely himself, and he called them higher just by the manner of his life.
Mm-hmm.
That is, that's a start, I don't know, you agree?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Katie does this in her spare time.
Yeah, she does. It's a hobby of hers.
That's right. It's why theology on tap is so important for her.
Mm-hmm.
Stop it.
It's a beautiful thing to see young Catholics living in that intentional community of others seeking after holiness.
I think that every day more and more I realize how much that I personally need community, whether it's with friends or whether it's with friend priests, that I see myself, it's almost easier to pray, it's easier to stay accountable to prayer because everybody else has the same intentions.
And I think that's true. Accountability for the Christian is also very important. It's so easy to actually get convinced of, I don't need to go to confession. I don't know. I don't really have to go to Mass today. But if you have somebody who in a sense is standing like Christ for you,
mm-hmm.
In a very lowercase sense in the person of Christ, right? If you have another person who's baptized who's saying, yep, I need it, you need it, let's go together. That actually can help to lift us higher. That can lift our mind and our heart to God. And what is prayer? What is true prayer but the lifting of the mind and heart to God?
And I think if anybody has ever been in religious communities, has stepped inside monasteries or stepped inside religious communities with sisters, you can so easily pick up the holiness. It's just this aura of holiness because the religious sisters and the brothers are so grounded in prayer and they're so accountable to each other that prayer and the Lord is the number one focus.
That's right. And let me tell you, having lived in seminary in community, it's excruciating.
Mm-hmm.
It is. I mean, it's wonderful and excruciating at the same time because you're constantly being held accountable, constantly. Mm-hmm. If your brothers aren't holding you accountable by what they say or what they don't say, then you know that the Lord is,
mm-hmm.
And that conviction of the heart is essentially like having poison sucked out of a wound, sometimes it is extremely comforting, but sometimes it is painful. And the road to holiness, as the Catechism tells us, passes by way of the cross. And it is the cross to which we are called. As Christ shows us on his cross what true redemption looks like through suffering, we also are called to hang on the crosses of our daily life. That we are. We are called to hang with Christ there.
Mm-hmm.
And not take the place of him, but to realize that in our daily crucifixions, we will also achieve the salvation that we long for through and in and with Christ. That's like something you hear at Mass. Mm-hmm. Almost at the elevation of the host, through him and with him and in him.
Yeah.
Wow. I don't know about you, but I think it might be time for that part of the show that we call
the CU Pick of the Week.
Ah, the CU Pick of the Week. Just when you thought we were going to go even deeper and deeper and deeper, yeah. Now it's time for a little levity. At least I hope so, at any rate. Well, actually, levity, yes. Olivia, this has been a Pick of the Week before.
Oh, no.
Yeah, Father Ryan picked it.
Oh, no.
But no, that's okay, because
we can reinforce
time,
how important
it's time
it is.
Again.
It is time again.
Because this is levity at its height.
Exactly. And it is tiny saints. They are these little, they're keychain
so
size. They're probably about this size. Yeah.
Really?
And Katie knows. And they're little cartoon kind of caricatures of the saints. And they have actually a whole bunch, a lot of them popular modern saints. And so you can always have them. We were just talking about community.
They're extremely cute.
They're so adorable. But we were just talking about community, you know, and what's more, you know, of a reminder of what you're living than little tiny saints on your keys.
They even have a Magdalene one, which I need.
Yeah, oh. I need the Mary Magdalene one. I need Padre Pio.
Oh.
Padre. Ah. I need St. Joseph. I want all of them.
Oh, Blessed Teresa of Calcutta's there. Mm-hmm.
Are you looking it up on your phone too right now?
I've got a computer.
Well, tell us where to find it.
That's right. It's in the show notes, certainly. If you go to CatholicUnderground.com, click on the latest episode, you'll find the show notes. Or if you just want to type shop tinysaints.com.
Yikes. I can't.
No, I'm not saying it again. Shop tinysaints.com.
But you did so well the first time.
Oh, I did so horribly the first time.
Like, they're on. Oh, look, our lady. Oh, she's cute.
You see, folks? Yeah. I love the fact that those of you who are listening on the podcast have a beautiful theater of the mind now of, yes. what these little keychains look like. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think when Father Ryan picked them, they hadn't quite found their instrument yet, and they were like stickers and things.
Oh, okay. They've evolved.
They have evolved. Innovation is a good thing.
Yeah. And it all comes full circle.
Well, that's kind of what we do here at CU. Katie, I don't want to deprive you of a Pick of the Week. Do you have one?
Yeah.
I mean, totally.
Yeah.
Imagine
that. Toads, picks, weeks.
No. I was actually just listening to it when I was driving in from Slidell today, which ended up being perfect because y'all are talking about St. Benedict.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the Benedictine monks from Norcia. They released their first album called Benedita. And it's the Marian chant from their prayer life. And chant is such a prevalent part of their prayer because it is prayer. And
prevalent part of prayer.
I didn't mean it like that.
Perfect.
But yeah, and so actually Olivia and I were talking about this because there of the 5,000 people in Norcia, 4,000 of them petitioned for these monks to come back.
Right.
Wow.
And this is a beautiful CD. I think it's got 36 tracks on it of just beautiful Marian Latin chant.
And so it's important to say that the Benedictine monks chant these offices every day.
Every
and so this is kind of a selection of some of the more Marian ones, right?
Correct. That of those in the office and then some that they just sing as well as different parts of prayer outside of the office.
Mm-hmm. That's right. It's not just perfunctory. It is prayer.
Stop it.
Oh, prodigious.
Indeed. So yeah, that's cool. I want to pick this CD up myself. Mm-hmm. Because one of the things I miss about being in the seminary, of course, I went to a Benedictine abbey, is Vespers and Lauds and all those sung offices. They lift you right up.
Yeah.
Mind and heart, bloop, straight up to God.
Oh,
so, good pick of the week. Jeff Blackwell.
Good. Yes.
Your pick of the week.
Well, as a Windows NT 3.1 user, I have found a little, I think a pretty cool article for you to...
Were you an early adopter of Windows?
Yeah, I started off, don't get me started here, but I will tell you, I started with an Atari computer.
Ooh. Yeah. I remember those.
And it was expensive back then.
Yes, they were.
And that was, oh, heavens, I don't know.
So basically Windows was just kind of a natural progression for you then.
Well, and what it's leading to is that little Windows icon that is popping up on for PC users.
Yeah, we used to call it the start bar. Right?
The lower right-hand side of the screen, at least on mine, on my computers. But it's the little Windows logo. If you kind of run your mouse across it, it'll tell you upgrade to Windows 10.
Oh, so, it's saying that now?
Yeah. It just
You have to register and everything.
Well, basically, if you just click on it, and this is coming up, what is it, July 27th or 29th, yeah. Thank
I'm
you,
waiting
Olivia.
To, Mr. Jeff.
Well, I didn't even know there was one.
Well, what'll happen is it's going to kind of download in the background. You won't even know it. And then whenever it's ready to install, you'll get the old thumbs up, or give it the thumbs up. But this article will tell you kind of what it's about.
Cool.
And this is really for people who have Windows 7 or Windows 8, 8.1. And it's a pretty interesting article. I got a friend of mine who is, registered beta tester for Microsoft. Mm-hmm. And he gives it high marks. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the best of Windows 7 and Windows 8 and 8.1. So read the article with the show notes are at CatholicUnderground.com, and you'll learn more about it. It's really more toward gaming. Most of the improvements are toward gaming users.
I can't even get a hold of Windows 8.
You might not want to.
You can
purchase it or win it in a game of chance.
That's what it feels like.
Yeah. What is your pick of the week, Father?
Oh, that's right. I have a pick of the week. I was going to say, it may surprise you to know that the Catholic Underground runs its live stream and everything exclusively on Windows computers. I never would have. I don't want to admit that, but it just happens to be the truth.
You just did.
I did. My pick of the week is something that we talked about a little bit earlier. It is Pope Leo XIII's encyclical on socialism. Quote, Apostolici Muneris is the name of the document, and it's an encyclical that you can get on the Vatican's website. It's actually very short. And so it's incredibly readable, and I think it can provide a good lens into where we are beginning to dip our toes even more in the United States and in Western culture. It's one of those what's old is new again. Really, socialism has never gone away. Communism has never gone away. It simply kind of changes names, And so that's my pick of the week. On socialism, Pope Leo XIII's encyclical there. Let us know what your picks of the week are. Backchat at CatholicUnderground.com is the way to go. This week, we thank you because Catholic Underground is possible because of people like you. If you want to join the growing number of undergrounders, you can go to CatholicUnderground.com/donate. And as always, Jeff, we thank our underwriters.
Yes, we do. We want to say portions of the Catholic Underground are brought to you by audibletrial.com/CatholicUnderground. Excuse me, audibletrial.com/CatholicUnderground. And also by Mystic Monk Coffee. You got more information at CatholicUnderground.tv.
That's right. Drink coffee, make monks happy, make us happy. If you want the show notes that accompany this episode as well as the podcast, head on over to CatholicUnderground.com. That's the place to do it. Facebook.com/CatholicUnderground. We're on Twitter at CathUnderground. And you can sign up for our live show notification on Twitter at CUTV Live. Thank you for joining us. As always, I'm Father Chris Decker, and we are the Catholic Underground. We hope we've helped you cut through all of that chatter. We'll see you next time.
From the Catholic Underground.